All three readings today are short and direct to the point. No discourses, no lengthy treatises, no highfalutin analysis of what God is like. All three readings, however, for their brevity, actually provide rich fare for reflection. Never mind the tomes and pages written by theologians that describe the nature of God. Never mind for now all that has been handed down by centuries of deep theological reflection on the Trinity. As a mystery, there is nothing anyone can do to make this important tenet of our faith become other than what it really is, a mystery to be accepted before it is an object of scrutiny of even the most perspicacious of minds to unravel. Mystery, however, does not mean utter unknowability. Mystery does not make of the Trinity something to shove under the rug, for it to be relegated to the deeper recesses of our mind, kept in a special compartment, where all things unexplainable, all things abstruse, all things that defy explanation find convenient storage. Sometime in my theological formation, we were told that there are basically two approaches by which we can speak of God. Yes, there is a whole lot we can know about God, for there is a whole lot He revealed about Himself, and therefore there is much we can say about Him. The first method starts from above, so to say. All talk about God starts from His nature. We start with a kind of discourse that begins with who He is, what God is like, etc. This type of discourse capitalizes a lot on what the human mind can say about what He is not. Thus, we can speak a lot about His so-called divine attributes. But there is a second approach that begins from where we are, our human experience, our own human historical trajectory. It makes much of our human condition. It starts from who we are, our earthiness, our embodiedness, our finiteness, if you will, but also our experience of longing for something beyond us, something that transcends our daily life, something that goes beyond mere existing in a world so limited, so taken up by physical, moral, and psychological constraints. Let us start with one such human experience. Let us take the case of something that all three readings speak so glowingly about, human warmth. Warmth refers to closeness. We also call this intimacy. Intimacy is all about the wish to get closer and closer. It is about drawing nearer, not social distancing. People who love strive to get closer to the one they love. Panorin niyo yung crash landing on you. That's intimacy. That closeness engenders warmth. For a non-biblical scholar that I am, I certainly see something significant in the fact that the Lord revealed Himself to Moses as a burning bush. Fire, warmth. How else does one interpret that passionate description that God gave Himself? The Lord, the merciful and gracious God, slow to anger and rich in kindness and fidelity. From the utterance of God, we get to know who He is, a God of love, of mercy, and of graciousness. And what do we make of Paul, who, having basked in the warmth of this same love, writes with so much solicitude to his very own spiritual daughters and sons from Corinth, to whom he dedicated two lengthy letters? In a mixture of fraternal warning, an expression of a wish, and of hope that ends with a blessing, Paul extends to his beloved Corinthians that same warmth that only come from one so blessed, so exposed, and so appreciative of what he himself has learned at the feet of the Lord. He thus could speak of harmony, peace, grace, love, and fellowship from God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The short gospel passage today is the real clincher. To Nicodemus, who came to Jesus by night, possibly someone who nurtured a secret wish to be his disciple, the Lord explained the nature of God as love. Yes, he said, God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him may not die, but may have eternal life. How can any one of us not have any experience in our lives that does not resonate with this expression of divine solicitude? How can we remain unmoved by the knowledge that God has not only drawn near to us, but has given us all, including His only Son? There is much here that we could dwell on for our enrichment. There is much in this powerful self-revelation of God that we need to reappropriate, given the fact that we were baptized in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. We started out our Christian lives with the mark of the Trinity. We were enrolled in the loving relationship when the love of God took possession of our hearts and souls on the day of our baptism. Theologians call this the Trinitarian dimension of our Christian life. Simply put, we belong to this inner circle of divine love. We too, like the Corinthians, like Paul himself, are continually basking in the warmth of God's love. What then do we make of all this at a time when intimacy and interpersonal warmth seem to be sidetracked? Bawal tayo magdikit-dikit, social distancing. So wala bang intimacy? Look at what we have now. We have plenty of gadgets that are supposed to foster communication, but there seems to be little communication between and among people, including family members. Instead of communication, murahan sa social media, bintangan, and so on. Haven't you noticed that even the Sunday Mass has ceased becoming a family activity? And each one goes at a time and place convenient to him or her. One goes at his or her own convenience, and even family meals are becoming a rare occasion. In the daily mad rush to beat the traffic, the first casualty is family togetherness. Just what do we make of this then? Allow me to go back to today's reading for clues as to concrete courses of action we can take. First of all, let us not be distracted by the what of today's solemnity. God is not about quantity. It's not about 1 + 1 + 1 = 3. Let us not get lost in the content of the mystery, the what of it all. Let us focus on the why of it. God is all about quality. It is about depth, width, and breadth of His love for the world, for each of us. Let us then go qualitative. Let us imitate Him for what He is to others, to us above all. The first reading would have us see God as gracious, merciful, slow to anger, rich in kindness and fidelity. What about us? How have we been faithful to our friends and loved ones? Have we been talking behind their backs? Have we been stabbing them in the back? Just how do mercy and compassion characterize our daily lives? How forgiving have we been? And the second reading adds two more traits of God for good measure. He is a God of love and peace. One wonders just how loving and peaceful we now could be given the daily dose of vengefulness and violence in all the TV shows we watch, the violence right now going on all over the United States. Just how hard are we trying to make of our homes a haven of love and peace? Remember, the family is an image of the Trinity. The family must reflect the Trinitarian spirit of communion and love. Big words, you say? I can name so many families right here, right now, who, despite so many odds and trying, are trying their best to live that Trinitarian character in their lives. The Gospel adds that final essential note about what God's love is like. Again, there is no quantity involved here. It's all about quality. That love, the Gospel says, is not self-centered. It is not love that exists only between Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. It is all that and a whole lot more. It is not primarily turned inward, but outward, to us, to the whole world. Yes, God so loved the world that He sent His only begotten Son. And then you say there is little warmth and caring in the world? There is so much selfishness and greed in the world, you say? Why, there is so much of their opposites. There is so much love in the world, so much graciousness, mercy, kindness, and fidelity. Look at the heroes that we had, the frontliners. Many of them died working for others. For those who bask and live in the glow of God's love, for those who try their best to see through things and events and allow God the space and the freedom to work through them and in them, there is so much love, so much warmth, so much gladness, and it is bound only to increase and grow the closer you get to the source of it all, God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you and keep you.